did not know from where the Black Pyramid had come, only that it radiated, kept us warm without fire, gave us love without demand. Everyone in the village felt the voice of the Pyramid as a fluttering in their heart, softly at first, stronger each passing day, until it became a triumphant choir that filled us every moment. We paid no mind to the gentle stinging of our eyes, or the small blisters that would appear on the skin of our arms. These pains were unimportant. The song of the Pyramid had rendered them so. Its great shadow, not foraging or sculpting or scavenging as we always had, simply basking in the warmth and comfort it gave us, letting the skin peel on our arms and our legs, smiling at the sky as we grew weak and complacent. We did not hunger, nor did we thirst. When the sun would set and the elders would light fires by which to see, I would hear them joking that the Pyramid was like a new mother, brought up from the sand to cradle us. These words unnerved me. My mother, my real mother, was always beside me. And her skin was peeling faster than theirs. Six of us went to bed one night. When we woke the next morning, we were five. A new monument, stark and titanic, made from the same black stone which composed the Pyramid, had grown up from the desert floor. No one spoke at all that day. My mother's skin was crisp and red, and she no longer had the strength to walk. I brought her water and bread when I could stand the pain in my eyes for long enough to see. Five of us went to bed that night. When we woke the next morning, we were four. Each morning brought us a new structure in the desert, a new empty hollow, a new trail of footprints leading to the Pyramid's great door. Those of us who remained would go to the Pyramid, stare at the door for long hours, pushing our hands and shoulders against it, but it would not move. Some nights I dreamed of the sound of grinding stone, the shuffling of footsteps, and an unbearable light. But if ever I woke, I would see nothing. There is nothing to be afraid of. My mother would lie without prompting, while cloudy fluid wept from her eyes. She knew what there was to be afraid of. What she meant was that there was nothing we could do. My mother and I woke on the penultimate morning to find that we were all remain. The hot sand was singing through the empty doors of our village. I asked her what the word oblation meant. Though she lacked strength, her head snapped toward me. She stared. Her eyes were yellow and rheumy, but I could see her fear. She asked me where I had heard the word. In truth, I had not heard it at all. I had woken with it imprinted on the backs of my eyelids, written on the walls of my veins, a sudden clandestine addition, like the bite of a nocturnal insect. I knew that the pyramid had put it there, as a warning, perhaps an edict. I never answered her, so she never answered me. They were the last words I ever heard my mother speak. The next morning she was gone. Nothing left of her but a trail of dragging footprints in the sand, leading to the pyramid's closed door. My final day walking to each of the black structures, pressing my hands and lips against their cold stone, wishing them goodbye. They gave off no warmth, and there was nothing in their angles to tell me who they had been. I could not tell which one was my mother. The pyramid's incessant singing had clouded my memory. I was nearly blind from the pain in my eyes. I told each one that I loved them. Then I returned to the village to wait. Things will